Dr. O'Neill will be our fourth distinguished Canadian, give our fourth distinguished Canadian annual address on Beautiful Friday afternoon. I want to thank everyone for coming here. I'm going to do this very quickly. I want to thank Mary Clancy and her staff from the consulate. All these people pitched in and helped make this possible. President Tinsley's office, especially Pam Parsons, Dr. Larry Richards, Dean Howard London, Dean Dorothy Oppenheim, Arthur Slotnick, and the people from the media services, the Canadian Studies faculty, and most importantly, you students who came here on a spectacular Friday afternoon, thank you very much. I want a special thanks for Susan Williams, who did 99% of the work for this. So Susan, thank you very much. Dr. Richards will say a few words, and then I'll get back up and introduce our speaker, Larry. Dr. Larry Richards, Vice President of Academic Affairs, in case some of you don't know who he is.
Due to the time, I'll be very, very brief, but I want to introduce someone very special here, someone that made this event possible and made today's event especially possible, and that's the Honorable Mary Clancy, Canadian Consulate to New England. Mary, would you stand? The consulate has been a friend to the Canadian Studies program here in many ways, more ways than I can count, and the gratitude is sincere. And we have now, I think, one of the finest Canadian Studies programs in the country. In my opinion, probably the best, but we need to get the message out that it is. And I'm really looking forward to the this lecture is one of the premier events at the college each year now. And I'll turn it back over to Tony, and I think we're going to give Tony a big hand, a round of applause as well.
Thank you, Larry. Just because he was late, Dr. O'Neill told me he's going to give everyone a $100 bill Canadian.
Printed
especially by the Bank of Montreal. Dr. O'Neill was appointed to his current position in October 1994. He joined the Bank of Montreal in 1993 as Senior Vice President and Deputy Chief Economist. Prior to joining the bank, he held the position of President of the Atlantic Provinces Economic Council from 1988 to 1993. For 12 years before that, taught the Department of Economics at St. Mary's University in Halifax. He served as a consultant to several provincial governments, as well as to the Canadian federal government. Dr. O'Neill is a native of Sydney, Nova Scotia. Kim McInnes will be glad to know. He received his Bachelor of Arts degree with honors at St. Francis Xavier University, his Master's at the University of British Columbia, and his PhD at Duke University, North Carolina. His academic awards include the Mackenzie King Scholarship and the Donner Fellowship. Dr. O'Neill is currently a director of the Canadian Foundation for Economic Education and the ABC Literacy Foundation of Canada, and is a member of the National Statistics Council. Dr. O'Neill is the first Canadian non-US based economist to be elected to the Board of Governors of the Washington-based National Association for Business Economics. I give you Dr. Tim O'Neill.
I can't begin to imagine what kind of threats you had to come out this afternoon and to stay here while we arrived a bit later than planned. I should say, although we made a couple of wrong turns, I'm used to that. In my family, my children refer to me I think lovingly, as the Duke of Doubleback. I always miss the exits, and I always have to turn around and come back, so this afternoon's trip was actually quite normal for me. I thought what I would do, because when I was asked to do this, I thought, you know, I could be a philosopher, and I know you've had politicians and who would wax philosophical, economists by training, and probably, I don't know, by nature, aren't particularly philosophical. And I thought, I teach comparative advantage, and I am not going to try to do something that I'm not I'm not inclined normally to do. So I'm going to talk about the economy, and I'm going to talk about the Canadian economy. I wanted to start with the long view of the Canadian economy, and I'm going to see if this will work. The reason for the title. It's not uncommon for colleagues and friends of mine in the US to note that every time there's a weather report during the winter period, there's a cold front that comes down from the north, and it's a Canadian cold front that chills Michigan and Illinois and all states east, west, and south of that. So I thought, let's talk about this cold neighbor to the north, and in particular talk about the state of its economy. I thought I'd start with the age structure. I did that primarily because of two reasons. One, if you look at the chart behind me, what you'll see is that there is a group in the age category 45 to 64, which is becoming an increasingly larger share of the population. I belong to that group. Most of you don't. So one of two things I would like, either your sympathy, because I'm so much older than you are. Failing that, fear. We've got a large part of the population. This is as true for the US as it is for Canada. So you should be concerned if we're a bigger part of the population and we've decided that we're going to live longer, you better know that and respond. So that's the first part. Second part is, this is the age structure that you see in almost every country. Canada is not different in that regard. The only country in the among the advanced economies that would be different probably would be Japan. There are countries like Russia as well. Countries that were physically very devastated, whose populations were devastated during the Second World War, have an age structure that's a fair bit older than what you see in North America. But the North American population structure is very similar to this. The other thing is that the Canadian population, quite unlike the US, is very highly concentrated. Quebec and Ontario, in the center of the country, and I know I don't need to say that, but let me just note it, have more than 60% of the Canadian population. Ontario alone is closing in on 40, and the point I want to make with that is there isn't a region anywhere in this country that even comes remotely close to that kind of dominance in terms of population and therefore in terms of economic strength. That it has been has its own associated problems. The dominance of one particular province, especially if it's a prosperous one, has implications not only for voting patterns and for strength within the parliamentary system, but also has impacts on the way in which economic development occurs, which has been a cause for a fairly different approach to dealing with economic development in Canada on a regional basis than has typically been the case in the US. The one thing I'll note here is that you see from the time pattern that the population shifts have been predominantly to three provinces, to Ontario, to Alberta, and to British Columbia. Those are the three most prosperous provinces, the ones which over the last 30 years have been the fastest growing ones. A comparable shift that you would see in the US would have been first to the south and then to the southwest. And one of the reasons, one of the key differences between Canada and the US in that regard is what you saw was a shift out of the prosperous, industrialized northern parts of the US into the south. You do not see that kind of pattern emerge in Canada through the 20th century. I think one of the reasons is one of the powerful influences on U.S. population shifts was the invention of air conditioning. It's hard to underestimate, or hard to overestimate, I should say, how important that was in creating a living and working environment in a part of the country or parts of the country that were viewed as inhospitable because of temperature in the period after the 1920s. Air conditioning is not one of those technological changes which transforms the economy in the conventional sense, increasing productivity and so on in the way, for example, that information technology has. But it has quite clearly in this country utterly transformed the way in which economic activity is distributed over the landscape. In Canada, we didn't need to worry about air conditioning. Before I get to this slide, let me put the Canadian economy in a context for you. The U.S. economy is about 11 and a half times the size of the Canadian economy. The problem with measurement, for those of you that do that sort of thing, is choosing, when you're looking at the sizes of the economies, which exchange rate you're going to use. For those of you who are specialists in this area, use the purchasing power parity. For those of you that aren't familiar with it, don't worry about it. The point is, the U.S. economy is over 11 times the size of the Canadian economy. Another context, California is about 1.5 times the size of the Canadian economy. The Midwest is about 2.5 times the size. New England is about 2/3 the size. So the economy of this region is 2/3 the size of the entire Canadian economy. That has implications, and I'll get to some of those. First, the industry structures between these two countries are very similar. Many people, including many Canadians, worry about the extent to which we rely on production of raw materials, on fishing and farming, on forestry and on mining. But you can see from this chart that while primary activity is more substantial in proportional terms in Canada, it's still fairly small. You're talking about 5% of output coming directly from harvesting, if you will, harvesting metals, harvesting fish, and so on, harvesting trees and food. In general, I think what you get is a picture here that the industry structures are similar. We tend to be somewhat more reliant on goods production, the U.S. proportionately more reliant on services activity. But the differences are not dramatic in that very broad sense. Where there is a significant difference is what we do with that output. It's hardly surprising that a small economy is significantly export dependent. And you can see from this graph, by the way, the global pattern over the past 55 years, that is to say, from the end of the Second World War on, when trade liberalization reemerged globally, because it had been fairly common in the period up to the First World War for global trade to expand faster than output was expanding, because countries were, and particularly led by the UK and by Britain and then by the US, were liberalizing trade, were removing restrictions to trade. The interwar period was a period of contraction in trade because of tariff barriers and other things that were put in place. And in the post-war period, that again shifted to trade liberalization. So every single country, with the exception of a few emerging market economies, virtually every single country, if you look at the proportion of activity that is traded, it's been going up. It's been going up in the US. You can see it was less than 5% in the early 60s, and it is now about 10%, and depending on what year you look at it, it could be a bit more than 10%. Look at the Canadian number. The Canadian number was always substantially larger than the US, but look at the explosion in the 1990s. Guess what happened? What happened was a free trade agreement between Canada and the US in 1988. It had the impact of significantly expanding the role of trade in the Canadian economy, and in particular to the US. The proportion for the US is so high that I had to use a different chart for. In other words, I had to use the right-hand side rather than the left-hand side. If you put the European Economic Community, Japan, and the UK together, they take about 7% of Canadian exports. The US takes over 85%. And that's a substantial increase from the early 70s when it was about two-thirds. So there has not only been an increasing reliance on exports in the Canadian economy, that increased reliance is directly linked to an increased, significant expansion in trade into the United States. And the similar pattern would show up if you looked at the import numbers. So the Canadian economy is very, very closely linked to the US economy. And while growth, I hope, yeah, it is, it may be a bit hard, oh, it should be okay. Canadian growth does, in fact, generally follow the pattern that you see in the US. It doesn't exactly match it. Just let me give you some broad indicators here. In the 1950s and 60s, generally speaking, Canadian growth was faster than in the US. In the 1970s and 80s, it was about the same. In the 1990s, on average, it was slower. The other thing which this doesn't show is that in the 1950s and 60s and into the early 70s, Canadian productivity was growing faster than in the US. From the mid-70s to the early 90s, Canadian productivity about matched the US. And in the 1990s, and particularly in the second half of the 90s, Canadian productivity fell behind that of the US, that is the growth rates. Now, why is that important? I don't know how many of you in the audience have taken Economics 100, but let me give you a quick lesson. The growth rate in the economy on a sustained basis, leave aside the month-to-month, quarter-to-quarter cyclical adjustment, over the long haul, an economy can grow at the capacity generated by two things. How fast the inputs it uses are growing, and that predominantly, although not exclusively, is reflected in the growth of the labor force, how many people are coming in to work, and secondly, by the efficiency with which those inputs are used, by productivity. So if you put those two together over the long run, and that's what we're talking about here, the differences in growth rates will be reflected in, will reflect either differences in the growth rate of inputs or differences in the growth rate of productivity. Since the population growth rates were virtually the same between Canada and the US, it's a productivity growth differential. That has other implications, including issues about how fast living standards can grow, because ultimately people can't be better off in a country in economic terms. Leave aside other dimensions of well-being, but in economic terms, you cannot have an improvement in the living standards of the average person living there unless you grow your productivity. That is absolutely true in every country. The labor force can grow and more people can participate in the economy, but if you're looking at the average welfare of the people who live in a country, productivity is the source of that prosperity. Our growth rates have at times differed. Our inflation rates have also differed. If you look on the left-hand side of that chart, take the period from about the mid-60s to the early 70s, you can see that U.S. inflation exceeded that in Canada. That was the period of the war on poverty and the war in Vietnam, where you had a dramatic increase in demand in the U.S. economy coming out of the public sector, which added to the already fairly substantial growth in private sector economic activity. If you look at about the middle in the late 70s and early 1980s, what you're looking at there is U.S. inflation higher than Canada, primarily because the U.S. was prepared to make a policy adjustment to energy price spikes in a way that the Canadian government was not, and so it got reflected in higher measured inflation rates initially. But the consequence of delaying the adjustment was that Canadian inflation in the period from the early 80s to the early 90s exceeded that in the US, and that's because in part monetary and fiscal policy were not as focused on dealing with inflation. And if you look at the period from the early 90s, you can see a reversal. The reversal is a result of monetary and fiscal policy in Canada being tighter. What do I mean? The Bank of Canada had a higher interest rate, created a higher interest rate environment than you saw in the US, and net the fiscal tightening to deal with deficits was more aggressive in Canada because the problem was more severe than it was in the US. So what I'm saying here is that if you look at differential inflation rates over that 40-year period, you can point to policy differences. The way in which governments conducted policy was different, and that had an influence on inflation rates, inflation rate differentials between the two countries. Our interest rate levels have been different as well. There are a couple of ways of seeing what I'm showing here. You can see that Canadian interest rates, by and large, have been higher than those in the US. In part, that's a consequence of the time period shown here. If you're running a higher inflation rate, you need to run higher interest rates. As well, if what's happening is that the value of your currency is going down, then higher interest rates are going to be needed to attract capital into the country. Generally speaking, and I'm talking now, going back to an earlier point, if you look over the last 30 years, generally speaking, the patterns of productivity growth have been fairly similar between the two countries. I indicated earlier there are differences. Sometimes they're higher, sometimes they're lower. But generally speaking, if you look at this measure of productivity, which is total rather than labor productivity, what you see is that the patterns of productivity growth are remarkably similar between the two countries. One of the guys in my department recently did some econometric work on this. And what it shows is that, and he's not the only one that's done that, what it shows is that the linkages between the two economies are very strong. And as a consequence of that, the productivity performances tend to be reasonably similar. The cause and effect, you might suspect, is from the country that's 11 and a half times larger than the smaller country. But nonetheless, the fact is that because you've got similar industry structures and because you've got high degree of economic linkage, it would be very unlikely that the productivity patterns would be substantially different for a prolonged period of time. In the long sweep of history, let me just go back to the 1970s. The Canadian dollar hasn't kept pace, if I can put it that way. You'll note, by the way, a rising curve here is a weakening Canadian dollar. The way in which I've drawn this is the number of Canadian dollars that a US dollar will purchase, and you can see that that has, generally speaking, been going up since the early 1970s. In the period from 1970 to about 1978, you can see that the Canadian dollar actually improved slightly. And that was a period when, in the middle of that period, I was in graduate school at Duke. This is when they had a lousy basketball team. They now have a very good basketball team. We had a good dollar then. We now have a lousy one. So there's some kind of, I don't know if there's any cause and effect there, but certainly the fact is we've gone in other opposite directions. That was immediately following. Remember I had a picture of inflation. One of the things that happened in the early 1970s was that Canada, which had been on a fixed exchange rate with the US, decided for anti-inflation reasons to unpeg the currency. Why would they do that? Well, because the currency was undervalued, so when it went up, because inflation was lower in Canada, Canadian dollar went up, what that did was make exports from Canada more expensive, it made imports cheaper, and so it tended to dampen growth and therefore dampen inflation in Canada. It also directly had the effect of lowering measured inflation. Beyond that point, you can see the impact for the next, about 10 to 15 years, the impact of having a higher inflation rate in Canada. We succeeded in doing that fairly quickly. Then you get the phase from both the mid-80s to the early 90s. The Canadian dollar strengthened as a consequence of both tighter monetary policy in Canada than in the US, and because the US dollar through that period basically declined against all currencies. This was after an agreement, international agreement in the mid-1980s. The U.S. dollar actually fell in value on a trade-weighted basis against all currencies by about 50% in about a 4 or 5 year period. Even the Canadian dollar has not achieved that that degree of decline, but it certainly feels like that on occasion. If you look at that period, that's also a period when Canadian businesses started to worry very much about the fact that the strengthening dollar was sending Canadians across the border to buy what had normally been a relatively benign movement of the occasional Canadian into from Nova Scotia into Maine or into Massachusetts, from Toronto into Buffalo and so on, became a flood. But by about 93, the Canadian dollar was starting to weaken up again and the problem disappeared. I think what we've seen in recent years is that the combination of a broad strengthening in the US dollar and falling commodity prices, which have a negative impact on the Canadian currency, combined to drive its value down. Well, let me shift from that longer view to the current state of the Canadian economy. I guess the first point I would make is that if you take that long view, it suggests that the Canadian and U.S. economies are not likely to be out of sync for any protracted period of time. But we are in one where I think the Canadian economy is likely for about a year to outperform the U.S. economy, not something that we've seen certainly in the last decade. First point though, the Canadian economy is clearly slowing. You can see that in the chart behind me where growth was very strong late in 1999, still fairly robust well into 2000, and then began to quite sharply slow down in the fourth quarter of last year, and that pattern is continuing into the first quarter of this year. Why? Primarily because the U.S. economy has been slowing down. Not something I probably have to say a lot about to someone living here, but where that weakness in the U.S. economy quite clearly shows up in Canada is through the trade side. I mean, that's the link between the two countries. If the U.S. growth sharply falls off, among the things that happens as a consequence of that, of course, is that U.S. consumers and U.S. companies buy less from Canada. So exports, instead of growing as they were in the early part of 2000, when the U.S. economy was growing gangbusters, consumer demand was almost 8%, for example. In that period, you can see that exports were growing at about 15%. In the first quarter, we have an estimate here that exports actually declined by about 10%, and that is very consistent with the pattern of growth that we've seen in the U.S. economy, from very high rates of growth in early 2000 to very low growth rates, growth in the fourth quarter, a little bit over 1% in the past quarter, in the first quarter of this year, probably about 1%, in the second quarter, probably about 1%. So what we're going to see is that Canadian export levels will probably continue to decline through the first half of this year. And that feeds directly into growth in the economy. I said earlier, 40% of Canadian output is exported, 85% of it to the U.S. So you're talking about an economy where at least a third of economic activity is directly linked to what happens in the U.S. U.S. slowdown means a Canadian slowdown. Consumers are still doing reasonably well. Housing starts have held up, I think, actually better than might have been expected. Consumer spending has been up and down, but it's still growing and still growing at a reasonable pace. We're likely to see a similar kind of number for the U.S. In the first quarter, but I suspect the sharp falling off in consumer spending in the second quarter. The business side of the economy, the investment side of the economy, is a far more mixed picture, as you can see from the charts here. In particular, the very sharp decline late last year in machinery and equipment investment. Let me tell you, every forecast is a story. That's the way you need to think about economic forecasts. It's a story that either hangs together or doesn't hang together. All that we're seeing here is exactly what you'd expect. A U.S. economy slows down. One of the areas where that shows up first is in equipment and software purchases. That is to say, in business investment. The same thing is happening on the Canadian side. The purchase, in our statistical series, we call it machinery and equipment investment, you call it equipment and software, same thing. The fact is that, unsurprisingly, as the economy slowed down, businesses less confident of the future pulled back from their investment plans. And that's showing up quite clearly on the Canadian side as it is in the US. If you look at building of structures, however, that's actually held up reasonably well in Canada. So there's a very significant difference here between investment in capital equipment and investment in structures. Well, how has the Canadian policy environment changed to deal with that? First of all, the Bank of Canada has cut interest rates and will probably cut them a bit more. You can see the right-hand side is our forecast. We have another quarter point reduction in interest rates left, if our forecast is right, for the Bank of Canada. The other thing, which I'm not showing you here, is actually a fairly important reason for the difference between the Canadian and U.S. economic performances this year. Last year, in the fall, the Government of Canada announced what it then called a revised economic statement. It turned out to be a budget, which they said wasn't a budget because they were going into an election campaign, and when the campaign was over and they won, of course, they said, well, that was our budget. We don't need to do anything else. We've already done it. At the time, I have to admit, I was fairly critical of the size of the tax cut and spending package that the federal government put in place, with the emphasis primarily on tax cuts. I wasn't opposed to tax cuts at all, for personal and professional reasons. I thought they were good things. But I was concerned that the government was going to provide too much stimulus for the economy that would simply have to be taken away by the Bank of Canada. Because if growth is too strong, someone's got to slow it down. And if the government is not going to do it with fiscal policy, then the central bank's going to do it with monetary policy. Well, it turned out that I had to eat my words. The Canadian economy slowed far more sharply than I had expected, and most other forecasters, by the way, I should point out, and that was because the U.S. economy slowed far more quickly and far more dramatically than anybody was forecasting. You'll note when I get the forecast wrong, I include everybody else, all other forecasters are included in that. If I get it right, I'll take entire credit for it and none for anybody else. But the point is that that very sharp slowing in economic activity meant that the stimulus that was coming from tax reductions, which would encourage, in particular, consumer spending, and the stimulus from additional expenditures, primarily by provincial governments on health care, came at almost exactly the right time, because they were being implemented in January, just as it was excruciatingly clear that the economy was a lot slower and was going to remain slower for a longer period of time than anybody had been forecasting a couple of months earlier. I should point out the Federal Reserve got it wrong quite dramatically as well. In November, I've got to bring somebody in here who's a big name. In November, they were worried about inflation. By early January, they were cutting rates out of season. That is to say, they were reducing interest rates before they even got to a meeting, which is very untypical, and of course they've done that again in the past week. So the stimulus from that fiscal policy package, which in November looked like it might be too much, turned out to be almost exactly right. In fact, it will turn out to be worth about a percentage point, maybe even as much as a percentage point and a half on growth. That level of stimulus doesn't exist in the US, you're going to have more out of monetary policy, but it'll take longer to have an impact. Fiscal policy, you don't even have the tax cuts yet, and when they do come, if they're as proposed, we'll probably have the impact of somewhere between 0.25% and 0.5% on growth. So not quite as much stimulus, and that's why the Bank of Canada is not easing rates down as aggressively as the Federal Reserve. So, if I'm right that the U.S. economy will bounce back in the second half of the year, that's on the right-hand side, and that's critically dependent upon those interest rate cuts having a significant impact on the U.S. economy, it's dependent upon the energy price reductions having some stimulative effect on the economy, and it's dependent upon there being a rebound in equity markets, which will help consumer and business spending because it'll improve confidence in the economy. Then, if we do get what most people would regard as a V-shaped recovery, a sharp slowdown late last year, early this year, and a sharp rebound in the second half of this year, then the Canadian economy will display the same pattern. Some of you who follow the daily press on the economy will perhaps know that there's been an alphabet soup game about what the recovery will look like. Is it V-shaped? Is it U-shaped? Is it L-shaped? Is it W-shaped? Or W, sorry, shapes. And I'm in the V camp. I have colleagues who are in the U camp and a couple who are in the L camp. I think there's even a risk of a W. That is, you get a sharp bounce back and the Fed has to tighten aggressively because they've eased too aggressively, and then you're back in the soup again with another round of, is it a V, is it a U, or is it an L? I'll also use the R word, but I won't use the recession word. You can see from this chart that there isn't a quarter of growth which falls below the line. So what I've argued here is that growth, while it will be weak, will not turn negative. So there isn't a recession in this forecast. There is, however, recovery. So if you're looking for which R word out of the alphabet soup I'm using, recovery is the R word I'm using. On the Canadian side, I put this in for a reason. I gave you a chart earlier which showed the similarity in industry structures between the two countries. This sort of locks it in. If you look at which are the leading and lagging sectors, I don't know what picture you have in your mind or have had in your mind about the Canadian economy. But if you look at the left-hand side of leading sectors, that's not a list that you or many people would at least associate with Canada. You wouldn't have aircraft in your mind. You wouldn't have electronic and electrical products. What you'd have is the right-hand side. Forest products, for example, primary metals. You might or might not have autos if you're aware that Canada and the U.S. Signed an auto pact in the 60s, which essentially integrated the auto sector on a North American basis. But I doubt that you would have had communications on your list. You might have had oil and gas, of course, especially now that BC, the BC Power Corp is being vilified for gouging consumers in California. So you might be aware that Canada produces energy. You probably know that they produce oil and gas, much of which is sold into the U.S. market. So that's a more traditional industry that you'd associate with Canada. The others are likely not. The fact is, over the last decade, this is not just a forward-looking, this is a backward-looking chart as well. Those have tended to be the leading sectors in terms of economic growth. Relatively small to begin with, but growing far more quickly than other parts of the economy, and a lot of them that would be regarded as relatively, quote, new parts of the economy. Well, let me get back to the Canadian dollar. About a month and a half ago, I went in to see, as I do regularly, the chairman of the bank to do an update of my forecast. And I was about to launch into the currency part of that forecast when he interrupted me and said, so is this the 12th annual the Canadian dollar is going to get stronger forecast? And I reminded him I'd only been with the bank 7.5 years. And he said, well, probably it seems like 12. I've been waiting so long for that Canadian dollar to strengthen. The Canadian dollar, I think by anybody's standards, is an undervalued currency. recent weakness, that is to say over the last year and a bit, is really a U.S. dollar strength story. Against virtually all currencies, the U.S. dollar has been improving. And you can see it from this chart. The Canadian dollar has weakened against the U.S. dollar, but has improved against all the other currencies, at least all the ones that are listed there, the euro, the pound, the Australian dollar. We like to compare ourselves to the Australian dollar, in part because they perform so badly. And you got to find another dollar that you do well against. And that's a good one. New Zealand dollar also works there. If you want to impress your friends at parties, you can talk about the Australian and New Zealand dollars, as well as the Canadian and US dollars, and the Japanese yen. The Australian dollar, to be a little less facetious about it, Australia is an economy which has similar characteristics to Canada's. In particular, the currency tends to be more sensitive to commodity price changes than would be the case in the other countries that are listed there. Well, I'll continue to forecast, as I said, a strengthening in the Canadian dollar. Part of the reason will be that Canada's inflation rate is likely to remain low. In fact, what you can see in that forecast is where we're currently at about 2% on our core inflation rate when you take out energy and food. My expectation is that that core rate will actually drift down. And fortunately for me, this morning, the inflation numbers for Canada were released, and lo and behold, the inflation rate for the last month was 1.7 in Canada. So my forecast, at least one small, tiny piece of it is actually starting to come true as we speak. The other thing that will have an influence on the Canadian dollar is the remarkable difference in the trade performances between Canada and the U.S. What you're seeing here is in terms of external balances, the U.S. has an increasing deficit and Canada has a strong and increasing surplus. Generally speaking, and this really is at 100, generally speaking, if you have that kind of pattern, the country with the worsening current account balance, other things being equal, is one whose currency is overvalued and will have to adjust downward. The one with the improving current account surplus is one whose currency, generally speaking, is undervalued, and eventually the correction will be upward in that currency. It may take a long time, as my chairman will attest to, but eventually that will happen. There will be some correction downward in the U.S. dollar. There will be some correction upward in the Canadian dollar against the U.S. dollar, and that's what we're showing in the forecast. I'll continue to do that even if I have to move that line to the right on a continuous basis. Finally, what's the long term? I started with the longer term view historically. What's the long term view looking forward? Canada has established a low inflation environment, a central bank that's focused on it. I think, in fairness, I should say that the Bank of Canada has probably been more focused on containing inflation and has a more clear view of what the inflation rate ought to be than would be true for the Federal Reserve. Canada, particularly because it's a small economy, has chosen to target inflation. The inflation targets are 1-3%. The actual inflation has been below the midpoint of that for virtually the last decade. In the US case, there is no inflation target and there's not even an implicit one. So it's a little bit harder to figure out what the actual inflation policy, if you will, of the Fed is. It seems to be, if it starts to go up and looks like it's going to continue to go up, we have to do something. If it's basically stable, even if it's a bit higher than everybody else's, we really don't care. And that's probably not, in the current environment, a bad policy. I mean, it wouldn't be a great policy if you're at 11% inflation and everybody else is at 2. But if you're at 2.5 and everybody else is at 2 or 1.5, the differential is not that large, the cost is not that great, and frankly, if you're a reserve currency, you're not going to have to worry hugely that someone's going to take a run at your dollar. A smaller, more open economy has more concern in that regard, and hence the inflation targeting has probably worked very much to our advantage. The second feature, I think, of the long term will be having finally achieved fiscal rectitude. We're going to hang on to it. And that will mean that over time, the total level of debt, which is simply the accumulation of all those deficits that we ran for 30 years, that indebtedness, both the internally held part of it, that is the debt that Canadians owe to each other, and the externally held part, much of which is held here in the US, but held in other countries as well, both will be declining. And in fact, they're declining as we speak, and doing so reasonably quickly. The third is probably a little bit more arguable. The US productivity growth surge in the last 4 or 5 years is probably at the levels it achieved not going to be sustained. But I think it is fair to say, and I would predict, that productivity growth in the US, after languishing as it did in most countries at very low levels from the mid-70s to the mid-90s, averaging here about 1%, averaging in Canada about 1%, that it's probably now well over 2%, could be conceivably as high as 3%. What you should do is take out a calculator and figure out what the compounding effect of rising, of increasing productivity growth from 1% a year to 2% a year is over a 10, 15, 20 year period. It is very powerful. To raise the productivity growth rate by a percentage point is a huge achievement. The productivity growth rates in the 1950s and 60s were much higher than they were in the period following that. It may well be that that was the aberration in economic history, but the fact is it looks like we may be going through a second, quote, aberrant period when productivity growth surges on a sustained basis. There are signs that that's beginning to show up in Canada. There are signs it's beginning to show up in Europe. And if my point earlier in the lecture is correct, that is to say that productivity growth globally, but particularly in Canada and the US, generally will end up tracking each other, then you should expect to see productivity growth increase to about the same growth rate as we've seen here in the US, which means that Canadian and US prosperity will be stronger as a consequence of it. The final thing I'll note is that if you're looking at comparisons between two countries, by and large, despite all the rhetoric and all the ink that's been spilled on it in Canada, by and large, changing tax rates doesn't do a huge amount to change the basic economic patterns. If you change personal income tax rates, then you also have to change things like spending. And one can debate endlessly what is the appropriate level and role for government in supporting incomes, in supporting transfers of incomes through income redistribution programs, in supporting publicly funded health care, and so on. I won't get into that debate with you. If you want to raise questions about it, I'm happy to answer them. But the one area where I think there clearly is an issue about inter-country comparison of tax rates is business tax rates. If you have a significant difference between two countries that are so closely linked together as Canada and the US are, if you have a significant difference in the business tax rates, there will be consequences from that. And what's happened in Canada is that the corporate tax levels 3 or 4 years from now will actually be fairly significantly lower than they are in the US, starting out a fair bit higher, say 2 or 3 years ago. That will have consequences as well for investment flows, both domestic choices and foreign choices about investing in Canada, and it will, as a consequence of that, have implications for productivity growth. I don't want to leave it on a tax note, so let me come back to the beginning. Canada's weather may on average be colder. Canada's economy on average is not substantially cooler than it is in the US. In the 1990s, I think we saw, however, a period when it was cooler. I think we're going to see a year in which it's a bit hotter. I think going forward, we're going to go back to very similar economic patterns. Whatever the weather patterns may be, the economic patterns, I think, are going to be very similar between Canada and the US. Not the least of the reasons for that is that the economies do increasingly become integrated. Some people in Canada support moving that integration even further along to creating a common currency. Let me leave you with the provocative, possibly provocative statement, I don't happen to count myself in the group that thinks that that would be a good idea, and I'll leave it for your questions if you want to follow up on that as to why I don't think it's a good idea. Thank you very much.